All right, cool. If you don't know what the show's about, listen, you're letting yourself down. We're going to speak to sort of footballers about their businesses, their investments, their side hustles, and get to know a bit more about what they're doing off the field. Mollie, before we go into that, I want the people to get to know you a little better. So you have 1 minute. Just give yourself a little superhero origin kind of story. No pressure. Take a deep breath.
Right, you got right, this.
Okay. And when you're ready.
Okay. So I guess starting from the beginning. So yeah, always been involved in women's football. What are my clubs? Tottenham for 9 years, West Ham, Brighton, went and played in Florida for, I think, 9 months. Came back, started a girls' football club in North London where I've lived my whole life. And then, yeah, from there, worked in grassroots football, academy setups, and then most recently sort of started my own academy with my twin sister, Rosie. And then aside of that, I wear like this other hat, which is a media lens, I guess, but which is, again, heavily involved in women's football. So, yeah, I work for Man United TV, heavily involved with the WSL in terms of the Barclays presenting stuff. So, yeah, if that's my, I don't know if my minute's up. That was a lot. That was pressure. Oh, 9, 8. All right. I think I've done well.
You've done really well. You have some time to spare. I like that. No, I appreciate you. I appreciate you coming on the show. And I think, let's sort of just jump straight in with the academy stuff. Talk to us about what it is, the vision. Like, I've seen, had a little look at the Instagram. I like what you're sort of setting up, the sort of ethos about it. But I'd love to hear from you where you see it going.
Yeah, I think the whole ethos around the academy essentially was about creating opportunities that when I was younger just didn't exist within the game, you know. And I think the female game obviously has come on leaps and bounds, but having an academy at a crucial age of 16 to 19 year olds, I think is very, very important. When I was 16, I had to make a choice between either carrying on and developing with my academics, or I had to choose between that and my football, right? And I remember being 16 thinking, I don't want to make this choice. Like, why can't I do both? And sort of wasn't a general thing to have girls' academies back then. So I just thought, as we get older and as opportunities arise, we should try and create a situation where actually no girl has to make that choice. And that's the whole point around level 7. It's about creating equal opportunities, whether you're female, male, regardless of your ability. And more so off the pitch. That off the pitch thing is really important to us, because look, it's great, we can all, if you can kick a football, well done, but also at the same time, football's an amazing platform to go and find your other passions, go and find what else you might be interested in. And I think level 7 will provide that platform that allows you to be in a football environment and be motivated to wake up every day and get on the ball, but ultimately get your qualifications, get your courses, get your work experience, meet amazing people along the way and feel inspired, man. So that's what it's about.
Yeah. And that really, really resonates with me, because I was at Barnet Academy with James as well. I think, what was that, 16, 17, James? Something like that.
Exactly. Yeah. Same thing. Same scenario.
And then, yeah, same thing. I had to decide whether I went on a scholarship. Obviously, I'd have to do the trial. So who knows if I made it or not, or go university. And I chose to go university, and I haven't really played since. I think it's really, really important. And I really love what you're doing.
Thank you. And that's what I mean. Like, even if I speak to you now about it, like making that choice, and I made the same choice. I went to took the uni route, and you know, at that time it was sort of like what society told you to do. It was like, okay, stick to your academics because that's what's going to get you far. But I look back and I always regret that, because I think, God, like, just, you never know what could have happened, you know. And do you have a similar sort of feeling? Like, do you sort of regret it, or where are you at with it?
Yeah, especially seeing where it's come now. So if I had a crystal ball and I knew now what I knew then I probably may have made a different decision. It was basically financial. Just thinking, I didn't really think there was much money in it. I like to live a certain lifestyle, as James will tell you. So I needed to have a job.
Not saying a word.
Oh, today you're quiet, okay.
Very quiet, not saying a word.
So yeah, basically I didn't really see the money in it. I think it was something like £5 a point at certain clubs. So I kind of made that decision, and now, yeah, it's kind of, the game's advanced way more than I could have imagined. So it might've been a bit different.
Yeah,
100%. And touching on the academy a bit more, you said like it's not just about what they're doing on the pitch, but it's a lot more holistic, right? So you got your player, your pupil, your person, kind of. So we're gonna shamelessly plug that in. Don't worry, I've got you.
Love that. I love that.
Those three pillars.
Love it. Say it again. Love that. Again, like that overview there was perfect from you, and that's our approach at level 7. You know, like, of course, we want to develop the player. That's the whole point in the football academy itself. And naturally, with the education route and having your BTEC attached or A-levels at some of our sites, you're going to get your academics sorted. So it's like football academy. All right, both them boxes are ticked. But what we needed to do is level seven needed to bring that cherry on top and create an environment that developed the person behind all of that, you know, because it's all well and good having these amazing opportunities on the pitch and, you know, you get told to do your work, so you're going to do your work. But that person behind, let's make sure that actually at the age of 19, when you leave us, you're way ahead, you're way developed. And actually you feel like you've come a long way in those 2 years. And a good example of that is we're creating these sort of wraparound programs and workshops that mean that actually throughout your 2 years, you're developing life skills, right? So I'll be honest with you. Even now, like, I can't cook, right? That's like a big thing. I cannot cook. And I'm, you know, anyone watching this probably thinking, oh, Mom, like, come on, step it up. It's terrible for me, right? So I remember, like, we were looking at all the stuff of going, what's like the crucial life skills that like I wish I was taught, you know? And yeah, so we're like implementing cooking workshops, we're implementing nutrition workshops, we're implementing financial workshops, all the stuff that actually we wish we were taught along the way. Where you come out and you're in this adult world, but you don't know them key life skills. So yeah, the player pupil and person, but the person for me is the most important aspect of all of that.
That's really good.
Listen. That sounds immense. Yeah. It seems like you're smashing out of the park. Sign up. Let me turn the clock back and just sign up. That sounds dope. Honestly, that sounds sick. That sounds so, so good. And I think the element that you're including the financial tips in there is so huge. It feels like everyone and their dog is now like a financial expert or trying to give advice on certain platforms. But really and truly, it comes down to the basics and the foundations and the fact that you're actually trying to install that within these sort of teenagers so early. I think it's key, and I think Seisha can obviously give a little bit more light on why it's so important.
Yeah, absolutely. I think there's so much discussion always about finance not being in the curriculum to start with. So the fact they'll have the chance to learn about some of the more simple things and not just put £10,000 in cryptocurrency on because you heard on Clubhouse will be really, really vital. Just teaching them about saving, teaching them about, I mean, do you touch on contracts as well? Agency fees, management fees, percentages, things like that. That would be relevant as well?
Yeah, look, the academy, like, will officially launch in September. So in terms of, like, getting it ready, these are all the things that, and look, I'm happy to speak to you after this, like, little separate convo, because all that sort of stuff needs to be included, you know, because, again, we're not financial experts. I'm not claiming to be. So it's about bringing in the right people that can share that side of that sort of insight and knowledge, because, like you said there, James, like, it's easy to turn around and just like give all this advice, but how do we know that it's the right advice? And that's what I think you've got to be really conscious of. So yeah, it's about bringing in the right people.
Like that. All right, cool. Let's get back onto the pitch then. And I think Seisha alluded to the fact that the money in the women's game wasn't always huge. Like, what was your experience with that in terms of just, you're doing exactly the same job as maybe the men are doing, but you're just not getting compensated as much? What were your thoughts process? What was that process like for you? Yeah, just let me hear it from your thoughts.
Yeah, really difficult. And say she would know as well. It, do you know what? I look at it as a really difficult time in my life because, you know, your passion for football was there, like loved it, lived and breathed it, but I had to work. Do you know what I mean? So you then had to become this person that lived all these different lives and tried to manage it all, right? So yeah, I guess the background for me growing up playing football would be go to school all day, you train in the evenings or whatever. And then when you get a bit older, you work all day and then you train in the evenings still. But it gets harder as you get older because all of a sudden now you're trying to earn money to like live your life. And then at the same time, you're still trying to train at that level, but you're knackered. Do you know what I mean? So you become someone that is quite resilient, to be honest with you, because it teaches you how to manage your time, how to, you know, regardless of how you feel, you've just got to carry on. And I think that it was a very good development for my own sort of life growing up, getting into adulthood and stuff. But I look back and it was tough times. And ultimately, it was the reason I stopped playing at that level, because I found myself having to make a decision between whether I'm going to progress in my career and, as Say said earlier, like, and live a certain lifestyle, or I'm going to carry on trying to chase this football dream that in reality, I'm never going to get to that level that is going to allow me to develop in my life. So It's a really hard conversation to have with yourself, because you can still run, you can still kick it, you can still, you know, you can still do all these things. And even now, like, I'm 26, it's not gone for me, but I had to make a decision, and to this day, it's the hardest decision you ever make, walking away from it. But you have to do what's right for you at that time in your life. And for me, it was the right time to go.
So how would you, I mean, what sort of tips or hacks do you have for people sort of staying in there as long as you did? So you might have worked full time, but now you have a bit more exposure to presenting and other ways to earn a bit of income. So is there any hacks that you can give to people that want to still try and hang on and push for a bit longer?
Yeah, no, I just think for me, like, anyone that's trying to, like, I guess, carry on with the football stuff, which I totally respect, by the way, like, a lot of my friends still doing it, like, they're playing in championship level or and still managing a job. But I've just seen that with my friends that find the jobs, like, I don't know, a lot of my friends are post women, for example. So in the morning, like, they work for the post office, whatever, they do that in the morning, and then they've got that break in the afternoon, and they go to football. And I think that sometimes it's about finding those career paths that allow you to sort of manage it. And I think if you find something like that, where actually you've got your evening to be your evening, and you can totally dedicate that to your football, then yeah. But as I said, I respect anyone that is still doing that, because I found it so tough. I had to make a decision.
Yeah, no, it's a tough grind. And I think a lot of people that listen to this, they might even still be playing like semi-pro, and that's exactly their lifestyle. They're trying to balance, juggle work, and then think, okay, am I earning enough to actually play for this level, play at this team? If not, then might have to drop down a few levels. Like, it's complicated. It's a tricky one. It is a tricky one.
I'm speaking like I'm not currently playing. I am actually currently playing. But again, it was that thing of dropping to a level that allowed me to manage my life better. And I think I've found that balance now, which is really nice.
100%. And talking about you balancing your life, you are doing your thing, presenting left, right and centre. So obviously you're doing your thing with Barclays WSL. Talk to us about that. I think you've got a podcast as well. How did that come about, and how are you finding it?
Yeah, I mean, look, the WSL stuff is a huge, huge passion for me and Rosie. And I think when we stepped away from the game, playing wise, we were like, look, we just want to have some sort of impact. And it was really strange, because in our last year at West Ham, when we were both playing, we were getting like so many more opportunities in front of the camera than we were like on the pitch. It was like mad. We're just like getting asked to do all this stuff for like the media side of things. So we start doing it. And I remember having a conversation with her in the car on the way home. And I was like, I think I like doing that. And she was like, I think I like doing that too. I was like, should we do it? And she was like, and then it was really strange. And then, yeah, long story short, we then got picked up by our agency, who have been amazing for us. And yeah, they basically directed us and put us in a position now where, you know, women's football has become something that is hugely a part of our lives from a media point of view. So the WSL, the warm-up show that we do every week, that basically warms up all the fans for the weekend shows, for the weekend games, and gives you a bit of a preview and insight into sort of what's coming up, has been a massive sort of learning curve for us as well, because at the same time, it is new to us. All of this stuff is new to us. So every opportunity and every week, we're still learning. And I think that sometimes when you're put on those sort of platforms, I think everyone just thinks that you are just, oh, ready, go. Mm. But, you know, it's a learning, like I guess this podcast would be, or whatever, like every week you find sort of like what works for you, what doesn't, and you've got to make mistakes on the job, you know? And that's what I would say probably one of the hardest things about media is that you can't hide. When you make a mistake, you make a mistake, right? But yeah, it's something you just got to deal with. But yeah, from that side of things, the WSL is huge, a huge, huge passion for us. And we're grateful to have that opportunity.
You know, I got to ask you now, Molly, you set me up. I've got no choice. What was the biggest mistake you made? Like, you have to tell us.
Do you know what I've got to say? And so right back when we first started, I remember always like overthinking everything. So like I'd stumble on a word when I was talking to someone and it would stick with me the rest of the time. And I'd be like, oh, can't get that out of my head. Yeah. Whereas now I've been so much better at just being like, oh my God, let it go. No one even knows probably. Right. No one's even probably noticed. But when it's you really hang on to things. So I think the media side of things are massive confidence. It's a confidence thing. And I think that you've just got to back yourself more than anyone else and then go for it, you know?
I hear it. Another thing then that I really want to touch on is, not that you have a crystal ball or anything, but the future of the women's game, and you've been involved in a lot of series like Ultimate Goal TV and stuff like that. What's your thoughts on it? What do you think it's going to look like? We've got the Women's Euros coming up. Are you optimistic? Like, where you at with it? Where's your head at?
Oh, honestly, like, it is only going in one direction. We know that. And you can feel it, like, the momentum from, yeah, let's say the World Cup in Lyon, that's when I saw you, like, honestly, I think where it's going is, like, crazy to think from when we were young to where it is now. And I think that even the last, let's say 3 years, if you look at from where it was to where it is now, it's scary to think where it's going to be in 3 years' time and then 3 years after that. So, yeah, for me, I'm excited. If I was a young girl right now, if I wasn't 26 and I was like a 10-year-old girl right now, I would be like, God, this could actually be my life. And yeah, I'm excited for anyone who's just starting their journey out of football. I think anything's possible.
100%. And I think even more excitingly as well is that brands are starting to take notice. So I know you're part of Tongue Tied Media, and Joe Tongue's obviously just really influential in the whole space. But in terms of, from your perspective, being in that media field where you kind of work with the brand, you're kind of seeing it, what's your kind of feel on it? What's the attitude towards women's football? Because it's a catch-22, isn't it? It's like you need the eyeballs there so that the brands can slap the P's, but then obviously you need the P's to elevate it. It's a little bit of a complex one. What's your thoughts?
My thoughts are that there are definitely the right people in the right spaces. Someone like Joe Tongue and the network of women in football, and I don't know, just all these like amazing organisations, but from grassroots upwards. And I think that's where the shift has been now. I think that what used to happen is that when there was big tournaments and stuff, you see that, you know, people were interested then for that short amount of time. And I think that now it's starting to gain momentum, regardless of if there's a big tournament on, you know. And I think that has to be with WSL, but also filtered that all the way down. And that's why I think academies like Level 7 are important. Organisations like Hackney Laces, Bloomsbury, all these like local community clubs that do so much for the women's game at a grassroots level are fundamental in making that game grow. So for me, I think the right people in the right spaces to make things happen now.
And Molly, can I just take you back to what you were talking about before in terms of your agency and your agent? And you said you're still learning and everything is a learning curve. So how did you, when you first signed up with your agency, how did you know, A, that they were the right ones, and B, what about the contract? Like, what's the percentages? How did you know that it was right, basically? Was it a referral or for other people that might be coming behind you and coming into this space?
Yeah, it was really like a weird setup. So I was actually at an event with one of my friends who was signed to the agency. And then, yeah, off the back of that, got speaking to, you know, Joe, Chloe, whoever was there. And then they wanted to, like, sort of meet quite soon after that, after meeting face-to-face. And I remember me and Rosie were like, oh, I wonder why they want to meet. Like, really sort of, like, naive to, like, that whole situation. But, listen, we had heard of Tongue Tied before. We always had said, and I'll be honest, like, we had always said it's always going to be them. Like, if anything was to come off this, it was going to be them. And then it happened with them. And we were like, okay, cool. Like, we were never wanting to go anywhere else. So, and I think gut instincts are everything. The minute I met Joe, the minute I met Chloe, and the minute I met anyone that was involved at that time, like, I think your gut tells you everything. And it instantly felt comfortable. And I instantly felt like, no, these are the ones. And they backed us before anyone else knew us. And they believed in us before I think we believed in us and what this was. So, for me, I'll never forget that. And they gave us confidence like that we've needed for a long time. So, yeah, I'll be honest. I only go on gut feelings, and I'm quite an emotional person, I guess. So I go on how it feels, and it felt right. But when it came to the contract and that side of things, so that didn't know anything, to be honest with you. Literally didn't know anything. And they could have turned around and said 60%. I would have said yes. Like, literally, like, it's mad. But that's just what it was, because, again, like, have not come from that world, you know, so weren't educated enough to even probably make a calculated decision. But no, it's right regardless. And yeah, they're the right people.
Fine. Yeah, because like you say, without any experience, it can be quite difficult to know whether it's right or whether it's wrong. And when you go for like jobs and it comes to pricing, do you just rely on them and what they think your value is, or do you have any more insight now than you did when you started about how much you might charge for jobs?
Initially no insight. And I always think that we were sort of educated really early on that obviously you've got to build to you know, you've got to build your profile, whatever it is, and we're still bloody in that process, you know. So I think that, again, that a lot of that has been dictated by them, and I want it to be that way, to be honest with you. Like, and I trust, there's trust there. If I didn't trust, then maybe I'd feel a lot different, but there is trust there. So that side of things, like, totally happy to have, like, no control. Don't need it.
I hear you. And is there a particular program, brand, or thing you really want to work on in the next sort of 8 to 12 months? Is there anything you're like eyeing up, thinking, oh, I'd love to work with a Pepsi or whoever it is? I just gave them a shameless plug as well.
Oh no, God. you know what? It's an interesting one. So naturally, like, Nike for me has been a huge brand. Look, I've worked with them for a few years now. But there's one of my friends that actually works for Nike has just started something called football yoga.
I saw that, yeah.
Yeah, football yoga. And like with this whole, like, with level 7 and everything that's happening there, like what he's created there, like, I'm really proud of him for creating that. And I think that actually where football's going, he's hit a market at a perfect time.
And Callum.
Yeah, Callum, yeah. So I think that actually what he's created there is really clever, what he's done. And I know that over the next period of time, we will work with him on some capacity. I don't know what that will be yet, but he's definitely one that I'm all over and want to work with.
Yeah, I can't lie, the yoga thing, you won't look at, you look at me, you wouldn't guess it, but I'm actually very good at yoga, you know, Mollie.
Like, are
don't,
you?
Don't let the looks deceive you. My yoga game, listen, my warrior 1, 2, and 3, crazy.
Do you know what? I think yoga is one of them things, and I'll speak back to Callum about this. Like, there's such a perception around it of like it looks easy, right? I think it's one of them things, looks easy. It is so hard. Like, I've tried yoga. Me and Rosie went to this class once, right? And we're like, oh yeah, just go yoga. Like, feel like we need a little, you know, minute.
Yeah.
So, go to yoga thinking it's gonna be like all chill. Yeah. Oh my God. I'm like stretching, doing all this stuff. And it was so difficult. But yeah, I respect anyone that's like at a decent level. So I didn't know that about you, to be fair.
My yoga's up there. You know what it was? So I used to go to, there was a group yoga session in my gym, and I promise you, I was the only guy in there. I was like 50-year-old women. And then the first day I went, I said, yeah, this is, I got this, man. She started doing one pose. Listen, I couldn't walk for like 3 days. I said, no. But obviously over time, you build it up, and then you get a little bit more flexible and supple, and your body just gets used to it. But yeah, no, first time in there, ridiculous.
Nice. So good for you though, isn't it?
It's really, really good. Okay, listen, I need you to look me in my eyes as I say this, okay? Right. Don't overreact. The word is gold diggers. Now, hold on. I'll tell you why I'm saying that. Because I'm under the impression that men can be gold diggers too. Have you ever had a situation where a guy's male has just approached you and said, or done something because of your status, your position, what you're doing, and trying to make the most of that? Or you've never really felt that or had that happen?
That has literally never happened to me.
No.
Never, no. And do you know what? I'm quite a naive person though. So like, maybe that has happened to me and I'm just like, oh, it's a bit much. Or like, you know, like, but no, I've never
noticed it.
That position. And I feel like I would also know that and I'd be like, nah. So nah. I'll be honest, like, I don't surround myself with a lot of people. So people that I am with, I really trust. So nah, never.
That would never happen. All right, cool. One of our sort of staple questions that we ask quite frequently is just to get a feel for what you're like when it comes to spending money. So you've got 10 minutes to spend 100 grand right now. Boom, the money fairy. It's with you right now.
Okay.
What are you spending it on? Go.
Put it down in a house.
Yes.
Yeah, straight away.
Oh, you gotta change your mouth. Everyone says this now, man.
You know Kev. You know that. From that.
Yeah, no, listen, Kevin... Listen, Kevin is one of my good friends. If I didn't say that, he would literally ring me and go, are you joking? Yeah, to be honest, I'd give it straight to him and he'd do something with it. So that's what I'd do.
I hear you. Another one that we want to speak about. So you do still play football. The change room mentality towards just like investing and finances. Anything strange, any odd bits of advice, anything people saying, yeah, no, honestly, Mollie, this is the thing for you. Like, you don't want to miss this or... Yeah, any sort of change room myths or stories?
Do you know what? It's really strange because most recently I haven't been involved in football. Like, I only just started playing again, really, and then we went into lockdown. So I don't feel like I've got to that position in the change room yet with those players. Okay. You know? And I'm trying to think now, would there be... I'm not sure if, like, that... I need a couple more months, I think, to get to that point. So let's do this again in a couple months. And then I'll be like, okay, this is what's going on. But at the minute, we're not at that level, I guess. But we haven't spent that much time to have those conversations. So, yeah, we can do this again.
The next question I'm going to ask you is spending to saving ratio. So how do you think the amount that you've saved has changed over the course of, say, the last 10 years?
Oh, do you know what? I was so uneducated, I guess, on the whole, like, saving thing. And I didn't really ever think long-term when it came to my money. So like money would come in and I'd be like, cool. Like what am I doing? I never thought about it. And I think that as I got older and as I started to educate myself more and being around like, I don't know, the Kevins and things like that, I started to really think. So now I'm in a position where, yeah, it does go straight into savings. But I'll be honest, like that's only been a recent thing for me in my life. And Rosie, my twin, has been like, she's really good at that. Like I need someone like that, because having said that, if I didn't have her, I'd not have a penny. Like I've got that in me as well. Like I've got that where I could just be like, it comes and goes, let's just like live. But she's like the more sensible one. She like keeps me grounded, like, oh, this crazy idea, and be like, should we just like go away for 6 months or whatever? And she'd be like, no, like put it away. I'm like, okay, cool. So I'm lucky I've got like this person that keeps me on my feet.
100%. And where do you put your money? Is it just bank or?
Yeah, at the minute, we're still in discussions, I guess. But at the minute, just in the bank. Just in the bank, yeah.
Is that intentional because you think it's safe, or is it just why you do more research?
Uneducated. Just don't know what to do with it, yeah. Not don't know what to do with it. I'm sitting it like, I'm not saying that, like, do you know what I mean? It's more like, right now, I just want to get to a point where I can get to a level where I'm like, okay, now what do we do? You know? But yeah, just probably, again, yeah, don't know enough.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Interesting. I think there's probably three main stages that I would say most people. First thing is paying down any high interest debt. So any credit card or anything like that, there's no point of keeping your money in your bank account and paying 30% APR every month. Then the next thing is probably having an emergency cash buffer. When COVID hit, I think it was like 1/5 of UK workers didn't have any emergency cash buffer. Then some people were out of jobs for months, up to a year, and then couldn't pay their bills. So always make sure you have some money liquid, and then you can think longer term and think about investing. But you can start small. So it doesn't have to be necessarily, once I have £50,000, I'm going to do this. It can literally be £50 a month going into an investment in ISA or something like that, because it's actually the pattern of saving. And then when you have a bit more, when you're a bit more educated, you can sort of increase the amount as you go on. So yeah, even if you have a small amount, you still can start.
Stuff like this is why I need you. This is why I need you.
No, I like that. All right, cool. Like, we're coming to kind of like the back end of it now. Looking forward then, Mollie, what's on the horizon? What are you looking forward to? What you got next, apart from the football yoga, of course?
Yeah, look, level 7 for me is where my head is at the minute. It's really important that our academy does everything that it's set out to do, and we're definitely in our infancy, so for me it's a massive focus, but it will always be sort of that project as well as our women's football stuff. And the WSL is something, like I said earlier, we're really grateful to have those opportunities, so keep pushing that one. And then as the Euros and stuff come around, just sort of be them faces too.
100%. And what platforms are you most excited about? So with the Euros and what you do, I think right now, anytime I go on socials, I'm just seeing clips of someone saying something insightful, interviewing this player or something coming out. Like, I think those clips are your building blocks for building brand and building reputation. But what platforms are you thinking like, actually, I'm really excited about this or that or that? Where's your head at with that?
For me, like, naturally, my head goes straight to the Barclays WSL. I think they do great work. I think that they show a side to players that people care about and people want to see more of. So as long as we can be a part of that, and for me, that's the platform that when the Euros come and all them exciting tournaments are about, that's where I keep locked on. So, yeah, that for me is the one.
So, yeah, we'd like to end it with a little quiz. I'm going to give you statements about players, true or false. 5 questions, 2 points a question, maximum 10 marks. Don't look so stressed.
No, I'm stressed.
So, false, you ready?
Right,
first one. Rachel Yankee stars in the CBBS show Footy Pups.
True.
Right. There you go. Knew it already. Okay. That's true. 2 points. Next one. Alex Scott was the first female football pundit at a men's World Cup for the BBC. True or false?
True.
Yeah, true. 4 points. Going well so far.
That's
good. Next one. During her time at the Chicago Red Stars, Karen Carney invested into a pizzeria.
False.
Yeah, it's false. Was that too obvious?
I can't imagine Kaz investing into a pizza place. Go on.
Chicago are known for their pizzas, you know. Best in town. All right, next. This is, well, you should get this. Ennio Luca has a first-class degree in law.
True.
I can't say.
But I thought the other ones were hard. So, I thought that would be like the easy one to get a little 2 points, but 8 out of 8. All right, last one. Jill Scott part owns a local running club in Sunderland.
False.
Look at it. Yeah. How did you know? Can I ask, how did you answer all of those so quickly?
I told you I'm a gut person. Like, I just like get this feeling. I'm like, true, false, true, false. But no, I knew the first two, and I don't know why I knew the first two. But
I thought hard about those questions. They're unbelievable, and you just like crush me.
I am buzzing with that, by the way.
Yeah, that's lit. Don't give too much away, but that score there is a strong one. Of course, it is a 10 out of 10, but still, you're not playing around.
Thank you.
Well done.
Thank you.
Well done. All right, cool. Before I start bugging again, I'm going to leave Seish to close us out. I can't believe what's happening.
All right, well, thank you for coming on, Molly. Being really, really insightful. Look forward to seeing you again because you've promised a second episode. So look forward to seeing you when things are taking off. All the best with all your ventures.
Love that. No, thank you both for having me. Really enjoyed it. Thank you.
Appreciate you, Molly. Anything you want to plug to end on or you're good?
Level 7, just follow it. Do you know what I mean? At Level 7 on everything.
Level 7 to the world. That's another episode done and dusted. Thank you very much. Make sure you're doing all that good stuff. Liking, sharing, commenting, all of that. Take it easy. Peace.